Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon or good lunchtime. Welcome to the session More Investment, Better Policies and Stronger Cooperation. What will be this session discussing is exactly in the title. We are looking at the investments, but in fact we know very well that investments needs to have besides reforms. So in order to perform and to be efficient and effective to achieve the objectives, they need to have as well some structures behind, some reforms and the system that is working properly. That's why when we speak about investments, this is often coupled with reforms. And we have heard it very often lately. It is of course mentioned in the annual sustainable growth strategy that has been adopted last week, and the accompanying document on the guidance for the Recovery and Resilience Fund. So investments and reforms are always mentioned together, and reforms as well are mentioned as well in the context of the cohesion policy. And in the investments and reforms, of course, are part of as well of Horizon. So it's a perfect moment now to talk about reforms, but we speak about reforms because we want better policies. And this is the second part of our title. So better policies means that policymakers need to be helped, indeed, to perform these reforms and to identify the right reforms and also to implement them. So today we will learn what are the tools that are available to implement these reforms. What is the EU doing? What is the Commission offering to member states in order to implement and identify reforms? And then the last part of our title is stronger cooperation. So can we use the tools independently, one from each other? Can the member states work independently from each other? And the department in the member states, can they work independently from each other to do reforms? And the Commission itself, can the departments of the Commission working independently from each other? So cooperation seems to be something that needs to be tackled. And we will learn today whether this cooperation in all these areas is taking place. So in order to explore all of this, I'm here today accompanied by a very high-level panel of very interesting and esteemed people. And here we have, I have here with me, in fact, a representative from the Commission, so Mr. Paquet, Director General from DG Research and Innovation. Mr. Mario Nava, who is Director General for DG Reforms, Structural Reforms. And online, we have joining us the Deputy Director General of DG Regional Policies and Urban Policies, in charge of cohesion, Deputy Director General Poppins. This will be giving us an idea of the Commission views, but what about the member states? Let's do a reality check. So we have invited as well two representatives of member states that have been engaging in the process of reforms, and we want to learn from them how it was, if they've used the tools and how this happened. So we have with us a State Secretary from Romania in charge of research, Dragu Ciuparu. And also connected with us is Gregor Wrocław, Under State Secretary in Poland for the Minister of Science. So welcome to all of you. I don't want to take much more time to you because we want to hear from everything interesting you have to tell us. But please, for the people as well following us online, you can start from now to check and ask questions through Slido. I think they gave me the title of the slide. I don't have it now with me, but anyway, I think, yes, it's hashtag RI20. So join us with the Slido, and there will be 10 minutes at the end of this session to answer questions and answer. So I turn immediately, without wasting too much time, again to Mario Nava. So you are representing DG Reform. So by the name, definitely you are. It's important that you are here with us today. So what is DG Reform doing? What are the tools that DG Reform is in place to support reforms? What is made available now and the plans for the future?
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, depending from where you see this. And thank you very much for the invitation. I think this is timely. I think the months that are behind us have shown how important it is to have research and innovation. I think somehow we held the economy thanks to research and innovation. You posed very precise questions, so I will respond precisely to the three questions. The what does DG Reform do? the how we do it, and the with whom, because that's the crux of the matter. None can hope to do anything alone. The what is very simple. The DG reform is the little wheel that transfer down to the ground the policies of the Commission. It's the little wheel which is between the Commission policies or the policies, the Union policies, those that Member States decides together here in Brussels, and it transfer them down to the ground in Member States. In the area of research and innovation, we have already cooperated with a high number of countries, including Poland and Romania, who are on the plateau with us today, but not limited to that, Lithuania, Slovenia, Belgium, Greece, many others, Spain, and so on and on. Basically, in research and innovation, we have two areas where we are very active. One, we try to improve the national policy framework for innovation. It's amazing how sometimes a simple law makes the difference from a very complicated law. And two, the other area where we have been very active is to foster the cooperation between business and science. Everybody of us who has been in science and in academia knows very much how sometimes difficult is that cooperation, and what we try to do is really to foster the two together. In so doing, we try to develop national policies and put them in line with the European Union priorities. At the same time, we have also special programs, of course, for SMEs, in particular to improve the technological performances of SMEs. How we do that? Well, till this year, we had a program, it was a three-year program that the Council and the Parliament decided 4 years ago, and it was a relatively small program. Now the Council has decided in the famous meeting of the 21st of July to first of all extend that program from 3 years to the 7 years of the MMF, so we cover the full budgetary spectrum, but also to increase it massively in terms of significantly in terms of money. Annually, we have an increase of about 35%. It's one of the few programs that has got a boost. I think this is probably a recognition of its utility, the fact that all the heads of state and government who met here in Brussels found that a very useful tool. So that program is a program essentially of technical support. It calls us on buying the best knowledge that we can find on the knowledge market and bring it down to the member states after having agreed with member states exactly what is necessary. With whom we do that, and then I'll conclude to respect the timing. We do it, well, first of all, with member states. Our program is a demand-led program, so we need from member states a demand, and we work on the basis of that demand. And then we do it with the relevant DGs. Here we have DG RTD with us and DG Regio, so, and we have done programs with both of them. Curiously, one in Poland, of which maybe the State Secretary will want to talk about, and with DG Regio also we have done several programs on the implementation of the science framework, of the national science framework. So all of these means that we have the ability to put together the different programs that we have in Europe, the cohesion funds, the science programs of DG RTD, and with that try to help. And then finally, the biggest instrument that has now been put at the disposal, at the service of member states, is of course the RRF, and DG Reform helps there for the design, the development, and in particular the implementation of the RRF, and this has been very clearly highlighted in the guidance issued. So overall, this is the picture of what we do, and the floor is back to you. Thank you very much.
Mario, thanks a lot. A lot of food for thought, a lot of tools, in fact, available. But let's now turn to Mr. Poppens, the Deputy Director General, DG Regio. And in fact, you are mentioning RRF. Of course, there is in the guidance a clear reference to cohesion policies. The regulation is ongoing now. The discussion and negotiations are ongoing. So Mr. Poppens, cohesion policy is indeed investing substantial amounts of money in research and innovation is one of their main, one of their key objectives. And indeed there is investments, but they are in your case as well linked to requests for reforms through the conditionalities. So what are the measures in place in the cohesion policies to support member states to identify the best reforms and also to implement them at national and regional level, of course. Floor is yours.
Thank you, Carla, and I hope you can hear me well. I wish I was in that beautiful room together with Jean-Eric and Mario, but thanks for inviting us. I think it's clear that Europe faces really big challenges at this point in time, and we don't talk just about green and digital transition. We are talking about also the COVID effects. And of course, from DG Regio, we approach this need to invest into our member states and regions with a motto that no region, no person, really no territory should be left behind in this process. Now, when we look at the research and innovation activities in Europe, we see that there's a quite a variety. And it's true that we have high-tech research systems and activities going on in certain parts of Europe. But on the other hand, you also have regions which are lagging behind, which don't yet know where to start really innovating. And this has been our approach already for this current 14 and 20 period, that of course we want to invest more into research and innovation field, but firstly, and there are 4 points I would like to make today. First of all, in order to channel investment into this field, certain preconditions need to be put in place. That is absolutely clear, and we agree, I think, with everybody that also key enabling conditions as designed for the next set of cohesion policy programs, they include, the first of all, the necessity to have a functioning research and innovation ecosystem on the ground, being at national and regional and territorial levels, and we need to work together with other DGs and with member states to make sure that these conditions are put in place to unlock the investment potential under the cohesion policy, but I also hope under other EU instruments. There's a close cooperation with RCD on this, under policy support facility, and I'm happy that we have Romanian and Polish representatives who are involved in this work. Now, secondly, for the cohesion policy investment, we have introduced the smart specialization strategy as one of the key enabling conditions. It's been running already for many years, and it's proven to be quite a success story. And that builds, of course, on the potential advantage of regions in Europe. This is not a top-down approach. I mean, we need to have certain policies in place also from ministries and competent organizations, but smart specialization does talk about all stakeholder involvement. We need to have everybody on board, starting from universities, researchers, but also SMEs, different big enterprises, local authorities, and different levels of governance. And this we will keep pursuing also for the future period. We are working very intensively with everybody to set up now our programs, and I can tell you that obviously the investment into the field of research and innovation will be featuring in each and every program in every region, every member state in the EU. So again, we need to work all together to make sure that we fill in these programs with concrete substance, which we can then implement and have impact also on the ground and in our societies. Thirdly, it's very important for the new period that we are working more intensively together with Jean-Eric, with our colleagues in RTD on the synergies and complementarities between the cohesion policy programs and Horizon Europe. We think it's extremely important to join forces and to see that, first of all, obviously, we can support projects that are excellent under Horizon Europe, but we also hope that more and more we will use the cohesion policy as building this stairway to Horizon that will allow, after we invest in regions which are lagging behind, that they will be able to participate in Horizon calls. We also hope that under this widening actions of Horizon, we will be able to support regions under which have designed their priorities for smart specialization strategies, and that we can even have joint calls in future with very concrete working modalities. So we hope that this will be more widely used also in the future set of our programs and Horizon Europe. And lastly, I want to say that we have also been thinking about different additions, how to foster innovation. We are introducing a new interregional innovation component in the new period. That's a novelty because we do believe that there's not enough cooperation between different regions in Europe on the same topics. And we will continue by addressing specific needs of our urban authorities, our cities, by also continuing with urban innovative actions under the European Urban Initiative. And finally, we have set up the network, the RIMA network, which is actually a network which brings together R&I national authorities and our managing authorities of cohesion policy, which we'll discuss and has started already to discuss the common practical implementation issues. And I hope that this will allow us also to really be united, to gather all actors together and work together so we have the same goal, and that is sustainable development, welfare of our European citizens. So again, thank you for having me today, and I'm looking forward to a discussion.
Thanks a lot to you, Normandus. A lot of, again, incredibly rich information. A lot of information there for Jean-Éric on a lot of tools that are available, conditionalities, we talk about synergy. So is this the right moment, indeed, to talk about reforms? What is DG R&I, Research and Innovation, doing? And, I mean, how can we help member states to find their way in this incredible amount of support tools, in fact, there?
Yeah. Please. Thank you very much, Mario, Normunds, Dragos and Grzegorz. It's a pleasure to be with all of you this afternoon. I think the very first thing which we can do and which we need to do is to reaffirm as often as possible that we need to invest in research and innovation. I think there's a large consensus around it. Research and innovation drives productivity, hopefully can drive better and more sustainable growth, and research and innovation will, of course, be driving solutions with knowledge for the green and for the digital transition. So I think this is a no-brainer. This investment is very much needed. And the consensus politically is there. At the same time, when you look at hard facts, investment is not happening to the needed extent. And member states at leaders level are very clear on investment in research and innovation. I think they struggled a little bit to be completely consistent with their view when they finalized the agreement on the MFF. Horizon Europe will be well endowed, but the Commission was even more ambitious. But then, more importantly, I think we need, and the Commission needs, to debate with member states in the European semester, in policy dialogues, including in the European research area, to help those of you which are trying to improve public and private investment in their member state and make with you the argument that this is an investment into the future. So I think the very first thing which the Commission needs to do with stakeholders is to help this public and private investment to take place. But then, of course, investment in itself is not delivering outcomes, and investment is not delivering solutions for the transitions if we don't have research and innovation systems which in themselves are delivering excellence and impact, and research and innovation systems which are connected to public policy making and connected to society and the economy. And this is where reforms indeed are absolutely critical. And there's a lot of effort happening in Poland, in Romania. I'm very much looking forward to hear the experience. A lot of dialogue which has taken place traditionally with DG Regio, and Normunds explained that a little bit. And then, of course, the structural support reform facility and the instruments which are now emerging under the leadership of Mario Nava and DG Reform are all focusing on helping member states set up research and innovation systems, university connected, industry connected, which foster impact and excellence. And I would like to underline that point because I think it's politically also extremely important that we all note that the debate in Europe has moved forward. The question is not, is excellence what should drive these reforms? I think this is now agreed everywhere. Everyone needs and aims at having excellence-driven research and innovation systems delivering the solutions and the impact which are needed. On the side of DG research and innovation, we are complementing what is done in the European semester in DG reform with the policy support facility. You have used them very well in the past. They feed also in smart specialization. And I would like to finish by saying that indeed the investment agenda, the reform agenda, is about joining up national and EU instruments and resources. And this is what is exactly the agenda of Maria Gabriel in research and innovation, co-creating and co-designing policies so that we can connect the output of research and innovation in making better public policies and a better Europe. And this is where investments and reforms come together. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Jean-Éric. So with these three key interventions, we have really set the full scene of the EU support, going, as we said, from tools, enabling conditions. We have also, of course, the policy dialogue you mentioned. So, Dragos Tsouparos, State Secretary, we were, in fact, even in a meeting yesterday with different colleagues from different DGs, and you are experiencing this type of bilateral policy dialogue. And I would like to know from you that has been involved in this type of a pilot, what is your feeling, your reactions to that, what is your learning, and what eventually can be improved? So, and have an idea of what this, if this is useful for Romania, what is Romania looking for and how we can best help? So please, floor is yours.
Hello, Magda. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share with you our working experience with a consolidated bilateral dialogue on R&I policies between the Romanian Ministry of Education and Research and the European Commission. In fact, the bilateral dialogue started in a natural way, sprung from our need to improve the Romanian R&I system, and nurtured by our wish to better integrate and contribute to a more cohesive and coherent European research area. We began the bilateral dialogue with the European Commission back in February this year, when we expressed our will for reforms based on the analysis of European semester recommendations for Romania and explored the possibility for having a PSF peer review as soon as possible in the context of elaborating a new strategy for research, innovation, and smart specialization. Initially, DG R&I and DG Regio were involved. Later on, DG Reform joined our bilateral dialogue. On the Romanian side, there were also other ministries involved, such as the Ministry of European Funds, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Economy, Energy, and Small and Medium-Sized Enterprises, and the regional development agencies, as you said, as being very important at regional level. So far, we had four bilateral meetings and a couple more workshops where we discussed our plans for reforms and investment and received feedback on fulfilling the criteria for the enabling condition of the next programming period. During our last bilateral meeting you mentioned yesterday, we started brainstorming some of the reforms needed to be covered from the Resilience and Recovery Facility, looking for interlinks between ERA and European Higher Education Area. The European Research Area is expected to strengthen the R&D dimension of our universities through a comprehensive transformation agenda in synergy with the European Higher Education Area, thus reinforcing their role as drivers of change, fostering their recovery, enabling shared objectives between the EU and member states' initiatives to support higher education institutions in their efforts to fulfill their education, research, innovation, and service to society missions. This approach is extremely effective for clarifying issues and having a common understanding of all options for the possible reform measures to be implemented in order to increase the intensity and quality of our research systems. The dialogue is also useful in identifying the potential funding instruments to implement reforms, creating synergies and complementarity between different programs within a multi-annual financial framework and national funds. It also enabled us as a ministry to have an initiative that would encourage less performing member states to engage in a consolidated dialogue with the European Commission to promote and implement consistent evidence-based policy reforms through the PSF instrument, which would eventually lead to our ultimate goal to strengthen ERA connectivity, directionality, and inclusiveness. A second initiative from us focused on brain circulation proposes to unlock the full potential of S3 research infrastructures located in less performing member states to attract and stabilize best talents. So far, our experience is a very useful and interesting one, and I encourage other member states to follow the path. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dragos. Extremely interesting and very nice, this mix of all the different departments from your side and also from our side. This is a bit indeed the purpose. Now we move to Grzegorz Wrocław. So Poland, again, very pioneering in using these different instruments. And in fact, you have been benefiting both for the policy support facility and also for the structural reform support program. So the idea is to hear from you what was the motivation from Poland to ask for this support and how you were able strategically to successfully use these tools in a complementary way as you did. So please, floor is yours.
Thank you. Indeed, we have a very positive experience with both tools offered by the European Commission, the Policy Support Facility, PSF, and Structural Reform Support System, SRSS. We have found them very useful to support both preparation of reforms as well as their implementation. So let me share our experience with Policy Support Facility first. This tool is especially important when designing the reform. In our case, we were in the process of designing the most ambitious reforms in the research sector in the last 30 years. So we call it even new constitution for science or science 2.0. The reform was prepared taking into account global competition in science and higher education, as well as our internal circumstances. We asked for PSF support to gain external perspective. Composition of the PSF expert panel allowed us to use the best international practices. PSF discussions allowed us to use experts' advice not only as the report, but also in the process of drafting the concrete solution. PSF experts took part in the meetings at National Science Congress. This was a series of conferences organized in order to discuss the new framework with wider audience, really wide. More than 9,000 participants took part in those events. And concerning the second tool, the Structural Reform Support System, we have used it to learn and to introduce best practices from other countries in the context of establishment of new Polish so-called Łukasiewicz Research Network, a network of research institutes. SRSS is more important in the process of reform implementation. It brings a concrete solution for a given situation. The SRSS support system allowed us to continue the reform of research institutes using the best practices coming from established research organizations. In this case, in particular, we team up with the Finnish VTT. It was introduced from the very beginning of the functioning of the Łukasiewicz network. We started, in fact, in 2018, and this allowed us to implement some of the suggestions in the design of the network. SRSS gave us the opportunity to benefit from direct advice from the VTT experts visiting Poland and to learn directly from VTT in Finland by Łukasiewicz network delegation. The whole week was dedicated to gain knowledge about different aspects of VTT functioning by asking all VTT staff, not only designated experts. The concrete results for Łukasiewicz network was the framework for network-wide knowledge transfer strategy, both inside the network and with external partners, from the personal level up to institutional exchange. The strategy accompanied by detailed implementation plan. So I would like to stress that using PSF and SRSS was so successful because we were convinced to use those tools. Using them only on the basis of external suggestions would be totally ineffective, I believe. So our recommendations for the future. First, keep the instrument simple, as they are right now, in fact. Second, instruments should be beneficiary centered, in fact. They should be fitted to the need of the benefits. And then please promote the use, not enforce it. As I said, the member states should be convinced to use them. Next point, the experts are really crucial. I mean, the success of, in our case, was because the experts were really excellent. And finally, allow for flexibility. Not every recommendation is useful in a given national circumstances or context. So each country is specific, and therefore each use of those tools should be very, very specific. Thank you.
All right. Thanks a lot. Very important messages from your side too. And now let's see whether from the audience we have questions to the speakers. For me, your presentations were extremely clear, but let's see if there are questions, and I should then get closer for the questions. So the first one appearing here, it's some countries in the EU have well-developed R&D systems, others not, and they are trying to catch up. To what extent the EU actions tailor to different needs and can serve different expectations? So I guess that the question is for our commission people. So of course we have here a representative from Poland, Romania, but would that other countries as well benefiting from these tools?
Maybe I can kick it off. So I mean, yes, the diversity in the union is there, and as we see with Romania and Poland, there is a major effort ongoing across all member states, not just to catch up, but to devise more robust system and everywhere to increase the public and private investment in research and innovation, recognizing that this policy area provides a lot of impact and solutions across the board. In Horizon 2020 and now magnified in Horizon Europe, as a result of the institutional dialogue between European Parliament, Council and Commission, we will now have indeed a number of instruments where we can differentiate the use to help this catching up process take place. This is what is called the widening part of the program, where the toolbox allows indeed through reform support, but also by funding, often jointly with regional policy instruments, the development of centers of excellence, but also by helping actors from these research and innovation system to become part of mainstream research partnerships, we can help with this widening toolbox, the catching up process. But at the same time, the catching up is also, I think, very much driven and accelerated when all member states participate on an equal footing on the basis of the principle of excellence in the mainstream of the program. And this is happening more and more. And the data on member state participation, I think, points across the board very much in the right direction, with more participation absolutely everywhere. That's certainly the result of the last cycle of investment in these member states, the reforms which were described now, the massive investment from regional policy instruments. It is starting to show, and we hope that in the next cycle we go to the next level.
Thanks a lot, Jean-Éric. Mario, do you want to intervene on the same question?
Yeah,
please.
I would say, I would just complement with a little thing. I fully agree with everything Jean-Éric said. And there is a point that I want to underline, which was mentioned by Minister Virochka, which is essential, is the commitment of member states. Because the commitment of member states is what allows us to go through the differences. There are, of course, countries are different. There is no doubt. They have different needs. But if they are committed in making a reform, we all know that investment alone does not pay. You need investment and reform. If they are committed to make a reform, that's essential. One thing I always say when we roll out this program to member states, when we present it, I say this is one of the few programs that is not co-financed, in the sense we at the Commission, we pay for the whole program. But mind you, is not co-financed in money terms, but is co-financed in commitment terms. You must be fully committed, and then it works. In our statistics, it's very clear. Factor number one of success is commitment. Factor number two is the quality of the expert. So I subscribe everything that it was said. You want me to respond to the second question?
Yes, sure.
The second question, I think, comes to... It's for you. It's the policy,
yes, the policy support facility.
Why don't you reply to that question?
Okay.
You're running it.
So. Yes, indeed. So what is the policy support facility that was, in fact, presented, that is the tool that we are using under Horizon, is, in fact, not only for the widening countries, because all countries need to reform, indeed. And, in fact, it has been used very successfully as well from, countries that one could not eventually think that they need some support. For instance, Denmark as well has been supported, and they've really appreciated, as also Romania just mentioned, and Poland, the support from the experts. So it's true there are different issues to address, but these tools are flexible enough to satisfy the needs of the country. And one important thing is that these are co-designed. So Jean-Éric was mentioning about co-designing, and this is something that I think is also for the tools under DG reform. This is something that is important because it's not imposed, is on a voluntary basis that this is requested and the service is provided, and also in terms of what to investigate, what type of reforms to look for, and the analysis of the system is done in full discussion with the member states in the definition of the area to check and to analyze, and also in the implementation tools and implementation measures that have to be taken in place. So this responds to policy support facility, but also for the other tools, for Mario and also Normundos. Maybe you want to come in on that as well.
Thank you. Well, the whole setup of the cohesion policy programs is based on a concept that we need to unblock the potential of all regions in Europe. And this is exactly why our programs put the smart specialization as a key concept. Now, when we look at investment under smart, of course, sometimes it's not at the level which Horizon would expect it to be. And this is exactly the beauty of it. We can start investing into the field of research and innovation also in regions where the potential is only in the beginning phase. And this is why we are so happy now to join forces. We tested this concept for the first time in 14-20 period. We have very good experience how our programs can target these regions. In Romania, for example, Eastern Romania and Poland, we worked with the World Bank to see how we can link the Eastern Polish regions to this concept of innovative investment and investment into this field. And it works. It can be done. But it's very good that we are now even more joining forces with RTD and reform through this support facility also, because, as I said, these reforms sometimes are difficult, and it's not enough for us to say we identify advantages of a concrete region. We also need to make sure that this investment then is put in this ecosystem which functions in the end. So, yeah, I think we have a great potential now to also get it right for the new set of programs.
On the structural reform support program, we have been running 1,000 projects in all 27 countries. And of course, projects are different. This is exactly what Jean-Éric was saying. So projects are different across countries, but we have been, for example, running a project, a very sophisticated scientific project in Germany, in Denmark, and so on and on. There is an important fact that on the structural reform support program, you can participate on both sides. You can be on the beneficiary side, but also on the giving side. And the example that was given a moment ago from our colleague from Poland is very evident. And when you are on the giving side, in a way, you also learn. So I think this working together of different member states, it's really what makes the success of the program.
Yeah.
Extremely true, and is on the basis of our programs as well. Is always we have advanced partner that most of the time says we don't feel advanced partner, we are learning as much as the others, and it's a very win-win situation and learning experience. We have a last question. I think this time is from our colleagues from Poland and Romania. It's a link to the smart specialization indeed, and it asks how we can guide the selection of the operation by the RDF, so the managing authorities can keep on on using the smart specialization as well? Because I think here the question is linked to this idea of this entrepreneurial discovery process where all partners are involved. So it's not simply a matter of a conditionality that seems to be imposed, but it's really a matter of having everybody around the table. So maybe Romania and Poland, you can say how you see this this process in your country, of engaging the different stakeholders in the discussion and the definition of the priorities. Dragos or?
Okay. What we did was to call on GRC to actually help us develop a methodology that would be comprehensive and will take into account all stakeholders involved and important to the process. So we kind of extended that approach to a national level, trying to have a coherent national smart specialization domains or fields that would be in coherence with those observed at the regional level.
Thanks a lot. From Poland, this process of co-creation, indeed.
What is very important, in my view, is the cooperation of many participants, not only different ministries responsible for funds, for regional cases, but also to sit in the table together with the representatives of science, with the representative of the industry. So we have a committee which regularly meets and discuss what should be the subject of the smart specialization. We update the list of smart specialization. And it is very important to build up a trust so that people talking to us from science, from industry, they really believe that what they say is important for us. And then we can implement it in the tools, in the competitions, when we give the money to particular projects.
Thanks a lot. I think, dear ladies and gentlemen, we are almost at the end of this session. We are 4 minutes, 3 to go. I just want to very telegraphically ask each of our speakers in 3 words, what is their take from the session? Mario.
Take from the session is that reform is absolutely essential, but none is alone in doing reform. I think there are a number of instruments on the Commission side, in the Member States, to help making reform. That's take number one. And take number two is that, and this I guess has been said by all of you, once reform is done, it pays off. It may be difficult to do it, but then it pays off.
Very good. Jean-Éric?
Well, investment in research and innovation also pays off, also sometimes difficult to prioritize in a national fiscal environment, and at EU level also, sometimes in industry too. It always pays off. And the second one is what we need is indeed synergies across parts of the administration. This is not the topic of this session, it's discussed in another session, but Normunds and Marc Lemaître and of course Commissioner Ferreira will bring synergies with research and innovation together with us absolutely to another level. And I think this will have a deep, deep impact. And this really pleads for what we call a whole of government approach. Don't devise your policies in your area, devise them with your colleagues.
Thanks, Jean-Éric. Normundos, please.
Well, I cannot say better than Jean-Éric already said. Our Commissioner Ferreira really, really would like to progress in this file on complementarities. To me, the key word there is cooperation and all-inclusive involvement of all stakeholders, and then bringing in both parts, reform and investment, together, and really also doing in our programs, matching the real concrete investment calls to the smart specialization strategies, to the Horizon Europe potential participation, and so on. So again, a lot of work ahead of us, but we are very, very optimistic for the new period.
Thanks a lot. So Norm, Dragos, please.
Words at the end. We are very satisfied and thankful to being involved in this pilot exercise, and we see all the benefits coming together. And we are looking forward to start our PSF peer review exercise later this fall.
Thanks a lot.
To conclude, inclusiveness and excellence are the two sides of the same coin, the European research area. In order to fully unlock the potential for excellence of our union, we need an inclusive approach. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And last but not least, of course, please, Rohan.
The three words about the instruments we have discussed, I would say promotion, simplicity and flexibility. Promote them to engage member states, keep them as simple as possible and make them flexible. And keep also the cohesion between the cohesion funds and the horizons, so we can use both set tools together. Thanks.
So I cannot add anything to that. You made my work very easy for the conclusions. So thanks a lot for this rich discussion. Thanks for the cooperation that is ongoing. And we really wish to continue like that with all our colleagues in the Commission and with you in the Member States. Thanks a lot and have a nice following sessions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Magda.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.